Well, as you are aware, we are on the verge of closure at the ICTR. By the end of next year, 2014, we should have finished the appeals which are currently being litigated, with the exception of just the Butare case, which we anticipate will spill over into probably middle of 2015, and then we would close. The focus of our work then now currently, with the trials having been completed last year, is on the litigation of the appeals and also on legacy projects. Because increasingly that is drawing the attention of the ICTR, not just the ICTR, but also the rest of the international community, which has quite an interest in legacy and residual issues, in an assessment of the impact of the ICTR. Has it accomplished its mandate? Has it made an impact in Rwanda? Has it met the expectations of victims, survivors? Has it met the expectation of the international community for peace and reconciliation? We had a lot of that this morning. And also, very important, at least from the perspective of the Office of the Prosecutor, are there lessons to be learned from the way we've carried out our functions over the years, which could assist national and international jurisdictions to actually carry on the task of investigating and prosecuting international crimes? The legacy of the tribunal, of course, is varied. You can look at it in terms of numbers and status of the persons who have been indicted and prosecuted. That's a matter of public record. The jurisprudence is publicly accessible from the judgments. What is not so accessible are the techniques and the strategies which have been employed over the years by various organs of the tribunal in trying to implement their mandate, and how these provide lessons for national jurisdictions and international tribunals, which will remain to carry forward the work. So at the level of the OTP, that is the Office of the Prosecutor of the ICTR, we have focused on this last aspect of legacy, with a view to identifying the lessons and the best practices that could be drawn from our operations, from our strategies, that we have employed in the past 19 years. We've done so sometimes on our own, sometimes in collaboration with the OTPs of other international tribunals. As early as 2004, at the first colloquium of international prosecutors, we did recognize that it was very important that the OTPs develop best practices manuals in order to provide lessons from not just successes, but from the challenges and the difficulties we faced, to provide best practices for national jurisdictions. We now have the primary responsibility for prosecution of international crimes, but also for the ICC, which we then expect will only make new mistakes and not the old ones that we have made. So in 2004, therefore, all the prosecutors commissioned a joint project for the preparation of a compendium of best practices in the investigation and prosecution of international crimes. It took many years to conclude. Fortunately, we did conclude it. And last year, we launched the manual at the meeting of the International Association of Prosecutors held in Bangkok. It's available on the website of that institution on a restricted basis. It's available to all national prosecuting and investigating authorities, and available to others also on a restricted basis. Since then, the OTP of the ICTR has identified other areas on which it has been carrying out work on its own. And amongst them, of course, there is the issue of transfer of cases to national jurisdictions. We had to transfer cases to national jurisdictions as part of our completion strategy, in recognition of the fact that we could not do all these cases, and that there needed to be an effective partnership with national jurisdictions for them to take over the cases. It was not easy to find such jurisdictions which were both capable and willing, able and willing to take over these cases. Very often there was a willingness, but then you'd find there were capacity issues, there were legal, jurisdictional issues, and other legal issues which disqualified many of these jurisdictions. And they were not just developing countries. Our experience with trying to transfer cases to Europe suffered similar setbacks when we found sometimes that the legal framework there was inadequate in some countries for the prosecution of crimes of genocide, of the crime of genocide, in that the crime was not adequately characterized in the legal system for our judges to agree to refer the case there. So we've had quite a lot of experience in shopping around and finding an able and willing national jurisdiction. In the end, we had to settle for Rwanda, not because it was able, it was willing, but it wasn't able. So it took a lot of law reform and capacity building efforts, many of which Sigal has spoken to already, before our judges would agree to transfer cases to that jurisdiction. But we've approached that whole process from a best practices point of view in terms of demonstrating what the challenges that you have to face if you want to empower a national jurisdiction to prosecute international crimes. And also in terms of demonstrating what needs to be done if the complementarity principle of the ICC is to be given effect. So we are preparing that best practice manual, which looks at our experience in the referral of cases to national jurisdictions with those particular two aspects in mind. There is James Arguin here, Chief of Appeals, who's working very much on that particular project. We'll speak more on it later on. We have finished another manual on the tracking and arrest of fugitives from international justice and recently published it also, and it's available on the website of the International Association of Prosecutors. With the exception, as you are aware, of the Special Tribunal for Lebanon, these international courts cannot try persons in absentia. So arrest and transfer is critical to triggering of the trial process in any of these courts. But the situation is that fugitives suspects of international crimes are hardly ever present in the jurisdiction where they should be tried. In the case, for instance, of Rwanda, all of the people we indicted had left Rwanda and gone to various countries. And so it took a massive international effort involving many countries and agencies like Interpol in order to locate them, secure their arrest, secure the cooperation of the countries where they were staying for their transfer to the seat of the tribunal. So the manual we've prepared on this particular issue highlights the organizational, the institutional reforms you need to take within the tribunal itself, such as setting up a specialized tracking team, the skills you require, the strategies you need to adopt, and the diplomatic efforts you need to make to secure state cooperation, because that is quite critical, to secure state cooperation in order to ensure the arrest and transfer of these accused. That's always a continuing challenge. The ICC faces a major problem. Most of its indictees are still at large. And so we hope, therefore, that there will be lessons for them as well from this manual in terms of dealing with their remaining indictees. Sexual violence. In the context of the Rwandan genocide, sexual violence was a major issue. It was quite prevalent. I think, according to the report, at least 250,000 women were the victims of sexual violence during the genocide. I'm afraid, within the ICTR, it would appear that whilst we've made some significant advances in terms of jurisprudence relating to sexual violence, that is not matched by the numbers of convictions for sexual violence. So we've had to really study our track record with the assistance of outsiders on some of the challenges we faced in prosecuting these crimes and what we think are the measures that need to be taken. There are currently two draft manuals in place, which will be reviewed in January at an international workshop in January with a view to their finalization. And we hope the University of Johannesburg will be able to work with us on that, to participate in those proceedings. We'll certainly extend an invitation to the University of Johannesburg to participate in that process. But again, it's manuals which we hope will assist national authorities, all persons at the national and international level who are involved in the management of this particularly difficult area of the justice system. Lawyers, prosecutors, judges, social welfare people, policy people, give them some guidelines on how to manage this area. Then we are looking also at, because the what happened in Rwanda in 1994. In the course of these years of trial in Rwanda, we've had various different kinds of defenses. We've had defenses that there was never a genocide. We've had defenses that there was more than one genocide. And so all those kinds of defenses have come up. It's been contested. But the tribunal, of course, has held that the genocide of Rwanda is such a notorious fact that judicial notice should be taken of it. This was the decision of the trial chamber in Karamera, presided over by his lordship, Sir Denis Byron here, who made that landmark judgment that judicial notice should be taken of that fact. But nonetheless, we thought it's important to put the issue at rest factually, that we at the OTP, we write out the history of the genocide, what happened, but based exclusively on the facts as found by the judges from case to case. This will be then a story of the genocide, but based on facts which are incontestable, because there are so many different versions which continue to come out there. But if we can write it on the basis of the findings of the trial and the appeals chamber judges, we hope we will then provide to the international community an incontestable account of what occurred during that particular period. These are some of the areas we are looking at, but it's not, I must add that there will be additional ones. We are looking at the issue of lessons for Africa, for instance, specifically for Africa, that can be drawn from the work of the ICTR. That's ongoing work. This work is being done not just I'm not saying for academic purposes. I mean, I'm not saying it in a negative sense, but we want these manuals to be practice manuals. We want the manuals to be used by national and international authorities. Already, for instance, the Interpol is using the manual, the compendium on investigation on prosecution of international crimes, lessons to be drawn. It's using it in their capacity building program or training of national personnel. They're also using the manual on the tracking and arrest of fugitives to train persons across the globe in this particular area. So we hope, therefore, that this product will assist in a practical way in equipping those who will take over the work of combating impunity, ensuring accountability for international crime, that it will assist them with the necessary skills, the necessary lessons from the past for them to carry on with their work effectively. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.